Nanka, chotto samishiku nai? Anna ni tanoshikatta jikan ga owatchau nda yo. Zutto kono mama natsu ga tsuzukeba ii no ni.
It's no secret that anime loves its high school settings. It's one teenagers and adults alike can enjoy, whether for being something they currently relate to, or else because it provides the opportunity to revisit times past. It's no surprise then that the majority of the titles that fall into this category portray an ideal, rather than the complex reality. But Sound Euphonium's dedication to an honest depiction of adolescence isn't just an attempt to stand apart. It's a confession of love. Sound Euphonium began as a series of novels written by Ayano Takeda, and was adapted for television by Kyoto Animation beginning in 2015. The series follows euphonist Kumiko Omae as she joins Kitaoji High School and drifts into their concert band, as she does most things in life. Hidden in this deceptively simple premise is one of anime's richest explorations of this pivotal period. Perhaps ironically, Ufo doesn't make adolescence look pretty. Exactly none of the bumps or blemishes are concealed for the sake of the audience. Throughout the show, we follow Kumiko and her growth, a journey as fumbling and awkward as any honest depiction of these years owes it to itself to be. Throughout the first episode, we see her attempt to adjust to this new phase of life. She even tries out a new hairstyle in hopes of making herself feel more like the new person she wants to become, as she finds herself once again drawn into the concert band and even back playing the same instrument, the ponytail finds itself ditched, as Kumiko realizes leaving her old self behind won't be so easy. Here, Ufo states its case, that growth does not have to be reinvention. The message the show instead opts for is only one of many I wish I could have heard as a teen, that growing up is less about becoming somebody new, and more about building a relationship with the person you already are. Still, even as Ufo acknowledges the ways in which we may struggle to change, it champions the small and large choices that we may not even realize are ours to make in our journey towards that transformation. When the band's new supervisor, Noboru Taki, immediately asks them what they want their goal to be for the coming year, they're confused. Aim for nationals had been an empty catchphrase, not a genuine commitment. Here, Taki-sensei is teaching his students one of the most important skills they will ever learn: to make decisions, then take responsibility for them. They weren't going to get to throw around phrases like that without meaning them. It's for this reason that one of the show's earliest conflicts concerns third year, Aoi Saito, a childhood friend Kumiko had lost touch with until entering the band. Aoi is one of the few students who seems firm in her vote not to dedicate practice time to the upcoming competition. She's juggling club activities with a university entrance exam prep and knows this isn't realistic for her. More specifically, Aoi knows the band is not as important to her as getting into the school she wants to go to, something she'd failed to do in the past. Aoi's ultimate decision to quit sets the tone for the rest of the series. Her bandmates beg her to stay, not wanting her to have to give up playing the saxophone because of their decision to compete, but Aoi only becomes more resolute. It's not that it's not a difficult decision to make, but it's less painful than letting both goals slip out of her grasp because she refuses to wholly commit to one. Whenever we see Aoi later, there's always an air of melancholy to the scene, but one that sharply distinguishes itself from pity. She has sacrificed one thing to chase after another. The loss is part and parcel of her journey towards fulfillment, a fulfillment only she can define. Here we reach Ufo's central thesis: anything worth having is worth hurting for. Aoi votes against the band competing so that she has an alibi later on when she isn't putting in as much effort as other people. Kumiko likewise fails to choose either option because she's afraid to commit. She's scared of letting herself care, risking the embarrassment of aiming for the top and falling short. For so many of the students, the concert band is their comfort zone, a place to do what they know and do it just well enough to feel good about themselves. Ufo is clear that it does not condemn this, but when the students do opt for nationals, Taki-sensei makes them own it. He refuses to even provide supervision until the students reach a standard that they themselves are happy with. In this way, for the first time, they are asked to consider how much more they might be capable of. It takes time for the band to come to accept their new supervisor, with his approach often seeming unduly harsh. What they eventually learn is that he is only believing in their potential in ways they haven't yet found the courage to, and pushing them to fulfill it. Slowly, we watch the students learn the joy of working hard to improve at something and seeing results, but just as quickly find that raising the stakes doesn't come without a price. The show is punctuated by these euphoric emotional highs and suffocating lows, as the characters find themselves intoxicated by visions of what lies just beyond their grasp, almost close enough to touch, yet more difficult than ever to realise. If you've ever taken up learning a new craft or skill, you'll likely be familiar with the maddening feeling of never being able to quite meet your own expectations for yourself, advancing and advancing, but the goalpost never getting any closer. Kumiko's character arc as she follows this trajectory is undoubtedly one of the most satisfying in anime. The show opens with her middle school band having just found out they've received a gold from the judges in the Kyoto competition, but won't be continuing to compete in the next stage.
よかったね。金賞で。悔しくて死にそう。なんでみんなダメ金なんかで喜べるの?私ら全国目指してたんじゃないの?本気で全国行けると思ってたの?
When Kumiko and Reina once again cross paths at Kitauji, they develop an unlikely friendship, drawn together like the opposing ends of a magnet, as they try to understand one another's outlook on life. Soon, Kumiko finds herself being pulled into all kinds of novel, uncomfortable situations. Nighttime hikes become her expressing her opinion that Reina should play a trumpet solo rather than one of their upperclassmen, in front of the entire band. Kumiko and Dena's relationship is wonderful in this way, as they challenge one another to grow as individuals. By the end of the first season, Kumiko reaches the realization that this wish to make it to nationals was one she'd had all along, yet never understood she could play a part in realizing. She'd never even begun to grasp the commitment those words required, the fear, the suffering, the sadness, all of it necessary. Finally, we see the girl whose heart was too guarded to understand Reina's tears shed them with her. Reina isn't the only character who influences Kumiko, though, nor the only character Kumiko influences. The band forms its entire own ecosystem, one I could hardly do justice to the complexity of in just one video. Still, the second season focuses in part on Kumiko's complicated relationship with band vice president and third-year euphonist Asuka Tanaka. In Asuka, we see embodied the concept of the role model, an idealized vision we have of somebody else and the life they lead, the opportunity for something to strive for, envy, project onto. This is the role Asuka plays for the entire band in one way or another, largely enabled by the impenetrable guard she puts up. Yet, in the end, we see that she is as human and as flawed as the rest of the characters, simply another teenager. Asuka takes up the euphonium after receiving it as a gift from her estranged father following her parents' divorce. What she eventually finds out is that her father is also on the panel of judges for the national competition. When Asuka is told by her mother, who sees Asuka's relationship with the instrument as a personal affront, that she has to leave the band, Asuka refuses her friend's attempts at intervention, not wanting to cause waves. The task of convincing her to stay falls on but one. One by one, Kumiko unwittingly knocks down her bandmates' defences, uncovers their struggles, and takes them on as her own. She is honest to a fault, a freshwater current gradually eroding every norm and unspoken rule the group had revolved around up until that point, and she constantly seems to find herself stumbling upon half-buried hatchets as a result. It's just as well, because with every difficult conversation she instigates, we see that these characters connect not despite their flaws, but because of them. The show is often disarmingly honest in its depictions of how these messy teenage friendships function, so reminiscent of my own from the same time, yet equally a constant reminder of how much more I could have done to genuinely connect with others. Euphor's implicit lesson that conflict is essential to maturation, and that a life void of it is far more often the one that results in regret, is one I now understand all too well. Euphor is, as much as anything else, an honouring of the power of art in helping us to communicate where words fail. Through their love of music, the characters are able to connect, challenge and understand one another in ways teenagers so rarely otherwise manage. When Kumiko finally works up the courage to tell Asuka that she wants to play with her, wants to see her achieve her dream of having her father hear her, wants to play Euphonium as beautifully as she does, it's another pivotal moment. Euphor revels in this kind of vulnerability, understands exactly how uncomfortable it is, and ultimately how rewarding. Asuka never considers that by not valuing her own feelings, she is hurting those who care about her just as much. She doesn't believe the rest of the band genuinely care about her predicament, and doesn't want her personal problems to become an obstacle to their goal. But they're an ensemble. Their resolve to strive for gold as a collective is built on all of their individual dreams. Throughout the series, through all their interpersonal struggles, they are constantly learning how to forge each of their voices into one cohesive sound they can call theirs, to fill their music with their own feelings and interpretations, to the end of creating something only they could have created. This is the band's genuine bond, and why each individual member's problems eventually become the entire group's. The goal to achieve gold passed down through the generations is a crystallization not only of each member's passion and effort, but of their shared bond and memories, all the ways in which the characters' lives have become inextricably intertwined.
Omoi-san. Hai. Asuka-senpai ka to omotta.
I only watched UFO properly for the first time as an adult, but I saw so many of the moments that made up my teenage years enshrined in the show's downbeats. As somebody who largely grew up on depictions of high school girls constructed for the enjoyment of men, it was an incredibly refreshing experience. It's a fine line the show no doubt treads with the help of co-director Naoko Yamada and the rest of Kyoani's female staff, but the key is in the lack of voyeuristic intent. Yamada describes wanting to create drawings that felt like a cameraman was recording the atmosphere of the world where the girls were in the middle of adolescence. Right down to details like watching the characters get told off for rolling up their skirts, I was immediately taken back to my own experience attending an all-girls secondary school. Every tiny interaction between the characters was so clearly crafted with the utmost care to feel like something teenage girls would actually do. And the show is jam-packed with details that never needed to be added, all for the sake of, if you ask me, giving its female audience something they could truly relate to for a change. I saw so much of myself and my friends in these characters and their relationships, and it left me constantly beaming. What's more, while Euphor may not bill any of its entries as gay romances, that never stopped me from relating to its depictions of love between girls, however accidental. A little over halfway through the first season, Kumiko accidentally ends up attending the local festival with Rena, despite there not even being on a first name basis. As they instead opt to hike up a nearby mountain, they finally begin to learn more about one another and explore their draw to each other. The camera switches deftly from Rena's delicate movements to Kumiko nervously appraising her own appearance as the two talk. When they reach the top of the mountain, Rena spills her heart to Kumiko, announcing her intention to become somebody special. This scene hit me hard. I related so intensely to Rena's desperate outpouring, her frustration at being unable to understand the people around her, her ambition, love, and passion for the trumpet, all her emotion, wild and uncontainable, and hidden underneath it all, her need to connect, finally laid bare. I adored the way the show continually allowed her to be stubborn and off-putting and hot and cold, because she's a teenage girl, and that's all she needs to be. Then Kumiko, anxious and unsure and utterly awkward, yet no longer finding it in herself to fight it, learning to let herself drown. It's an ethereal moment of intimacy, one where you can feel Kumiko submitting herself to everything she's feeling in spite of all her fear. It's exactly the kind of scene I needed as a 14-year-old girl who was beginning to fall for other girls, simultaneously the both of them, afraid of so many things, yet equally set free. Conversely, one of the series' films, Liz and the Bluebird, follows the end of a relationship. Mizore Yoroizuka and Nozomi Kasaki are in the year above Kumiko, and met in middle school after Nozomi proposed they join the band together. While Nozomi is a popular member of the band and only sees Mizore as one of many friends, Mizore ultimately plays oboe and stays in the ensemble purely to try and maintain this bond. In her eyes, her only truly close and most important friendship. Mizore's dependency on Nozomi, the first person ever to reach out to her and break through her shell, is painfully evocative of how these kinds of relationships can contort and become a source of torment at an age where we feel so fragile. The simple fear that you might not be as important to somebody as they are to you was the one that plagued me more than any other during this time in my life. As Mizore and Nozomi prepare for the duet they will play during the competition, they are forced to confront the nature of their relationship, Mizore's growing fear of losing Nozomi again after she had temporarily quit the band the year prior, and Nozomi's growing resentment towards Mizore over her skill as a musician that Nozomi cannot match up to. It is overwhelmingly a film about loss, an inevitable ending drawing ever nearer. The moment where your throat closes up before a goodbye, extended to 90 excruciating, beautiful minutes. The film is bookended by two words, seemingly contradictory. The two only reach true unity, understanding, and collaboration in deciding to part ways. They remain friends, yet as Mizore decides to attend music school alone and stops lowering her skill level to Nozomi's for the duet, we understand that the two have acknowledged their need to function and live as independent beings, that they are holding one another back, that something needs to change, not because they have stopped loving one another, but because they love one another so much it has come to suffocate and stifle them. Of course, they take all the ways in which they have shaped and changed one another with them. There's something beautiful in how Mizore, who only began playing oboe seriously because of Nozomi, now reclaims the instrument as her own. She honours the complex history it holds for her, and opts not to discard it, but to have it become an emblem of her growth. The film understands that choosing to move forwards, even when it hurts, is the bravest and most difficult thing these characters can do. On the face of it, the film might seem more like Yufo's distant cousin, with its distinct art style, almost complete omission of Kumiko and friends, and change in director. It was Yamada, rather than Ishihara, who helmed this project. Yet this only serves to underline the series' true message, that adolescence is, above all else, an exercise in grief. Yufo has an obsession with reminding us that everything is ending. In some ways, it feels like a reminiscence on adolescence through the eyes of an adult, forever focused on the moments. Moments where something begins. Moments where something ends. Moments of connection. Moments we often only realize the value of once they've become memories. Encompassing it all is the band's journey towards nationals, the fear that it will draw to a premature conclusion, the constant awareness that they need to enjoy every moment for this reason, the very thing that robs them of the ability to do so. The band won't know they've shared their last performance until it's already over. But that's exactly why it all matters. I have to wonder how much UFO might have changed my life had I watched it as a teenager. How many important things it could have taught me to treasure. How many difficult decisions it might have pushed me to make sooner. I'll never know. But that's okay, because these are the things we only realize looking back. Still, it's a show that helped teach me that pain is something to be honored. A privilege. A sign that you've found something or someone worth hurting for, and that's a lesson I'll never stop needing. During Kumiko's hike with Rena, she remarks, "This must be how it feels to lose your life, drawn to a beautiful thing, despite your fears." At Sound Euphonium's core is one simple question. What's the point? Why do we do this to ourselves? Why do we throw open our hearts to the possibility of pain? Why do we let ourselves care, knowing how much we have to lose? Again and again and again. There's a helplessness to it all. Every time we see these characters shed bitter tears over the things they've lost, but they've gained so much more. Above all, the ability to look back without a single regret. They might not understand that yet, but they will.